Speed, which is Emir Hlupcuk's view on and tea stratifications. And yeah, okay, our works have gone in slightly different directions. So, but yeah, okay, maybe there's also there's some common definitions. So maybe some of you will see repeats because I'm not assuming that anyone will. I mean, yeah. So good. So therefore, yeah, so you say, what's the, so there's a basic setting. So I mean, choosing a setting. So if we think of algebraic, to be concrete, we think of algebraic subsets of the complex numbers. So what I mean, so concretely, that's n tuples of complex numbers which satisfy finite bunch of polynomial conditions. Okay, great. Yeah. So an algebraic, yeah. So algebraic. Algebraic sets. Okay. Polynomials come from C over C. And great. Okay. So there's lots of, okay. There's lots of nice subsets. I mean, lots of nice subsets you can define. Yeah. Pablo. Okay. Well, so I mean, what's the idea here? So, okay. Well, so an example. So this is what I've been practicing drawing. So, e.g., so if we take the polynomial x squared minus y squared z equals 0, Pablo already took the canonical example, so I had to spend time practicing a different example here. So yeah, these drawings are tricky, right? So that defines, so we've got three variables that define and one polynomial that defines a surface in C3. And here we go.
Sorry, there's a problem with your microphone, apparently.
Oh, is there? Oh, sorry. Am I there? Hello? Hello?
Oh, thank, it's good, thank you.
It's good now?
Thank
Okay,
you.
is it good still now if I take my hand away? Okay, good. Okay, so here I am. So here's my, this goes over here. This goes over here. Yeah, okay, so this defines this surface here. Let's think about it. So here's the y-axis going up and down here. We've got here a kind of squeezing coming in on the, from in here. And so here, there's this kind of a crease in the middle here where these, branches touch together. Okay, so that's a nice surface. And so here I have done a bit of cheating because this would have taken, so as a so motivation. So what's a stratification in general? So coming from geometry, differential geometry, and well, in many parts of geometry, you get some kind of stratification. And so the general notion of stratification, so I hope you apologize that I cheated a bit here, but yeah, maybe this is, I mean, this is kind of motivating of what's going on. So I thought it's okay to talk through in order that I can get through what I hope, what I intended to say. Yeah, the kind of new definition. So yeah, I mean, this is kind of the general philosophy is that a stratification reflecting an algebraic set X is a partition of the whole space Cn here into pieces, in a way that you're capturing how, I mean, the level of sing, I mean, the singular singularities in this stratification. Yeah. So, and in each, so each of these parts should be smooth for a classical classification, a smooth manifold, and each should have a dimension at most d. That's what it's saying. Yeah. If you take the union, if you take the union down the strata, so S less than or equal to D, that's a closed set in C to the N in the natural topology. And X itself should be a union of perhaps connected components of these parts SI, and the whole and what's important and the tricky, the tricky thing and what gives rise to different types of stratifications is that it shouldn't just pick out singular points, singular lines, singular planes. They should also fit together well, satisfying some regularity conditions. Okay, so differential geometers would be used to this, and then but these are quite tricky thing. These regularity conditions involve or conditions on tangent spaces and so on. Okay,
David, question here?
Oh, hello.
On the numbering there of your stratification, can we go back and look at that again?
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
So you're restricting that the S, you numbered your parts of your partition S0 up to SN.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But condition one says that if you take, say, the second element, the dimension has to be less than or equal to 2. So you cannot have all the pieces of dimension one, all the dimension one part of your set has to be in S1. You cannot have more than, if your set X has a given dimension, you cannot have more pieces in the stratification than that dimension.
Exactly. Yeah. So you have exactly. Yeah. So maybe that. Yeah. That's not so clear. Thanks. Indeed. Yeah. So here, this is a kind of the singular points. I mean, dimension zero pieces. This is singular points, and S1 is a singular lines where you have a certain amount of regularity, but only in one dimension. So this is in singular lines.
Okay, thanks. Got it.
Yeah, lines. And indeed. So this is the N here is the same as the N of the ambient space. And so maybe I'll illustrate that in the example. You basically have the singular lines are all in the S1. And the singular planes are all in the S2 part. And then so here in our example, which is, this is of course a drawing in a bit in R3, but I'm pretending it's C3. What are we going to have? We definitely obviously have this as a singular line in where there's kind of this pinch line, because here, the informal idea is that we're kind of roughly translation invariant in at least one direction, in one direction. And here we've got a kind of the cross section looks like a cross all the way down. We've kind of got a little cross going all the way down here. Okay. And so this is definitely in S1. So this line here is in the S1. That's certainly a singular line. And certainly these kind of regular points on the smooth part of the surface, they've got nice neighborhoods where it's kind of flat. It's natural to put them into, so this is the set X. So X without S1 is then naturally, we'll choose that to be S2. And the S3 then is then the whole space C3 without without X will be set to be C3. Okay, and that's a three-dimensional space. The S2 is two-dimensional, and there's kind of two connected components. There's a bit of S2 here and there's a bit of S2 here, and which is separated by this S1 here. And is there anything that should be in S0? Is this point down here? Because if you take a neighborhood of a ball around here, you can't even look, you can't even go down. Yeah, so this is even worse singularity than the line above it. So this is the point that you put in S0. So, okay, as promised, this is somewhat informal, right? Again, it turns out it's a Whitney stratification. It does, so I haven't said, so okay, I think we can just quickly see. So each of these is a smooth manifold of the correct dimension. If you take the union of the point and the line that's closed, I mean, that line is extending off to above infinity, it's a whole, the upper z-axis, so that's it's closed. And the set itself is a union of well, the S of S1, S0, S1, and S2. And okay, I haven't said anything about regularity conditions, because in a way, that's what the, yeah, I mean, the motivation of a new type of definition of, yeah, of stratification, which maybe doesn't use the classical notion of regularity. Okay, but yeah, famous ones would have been useful Whitney's regularity conditions B, and this stratification does indeed, I'll promise you that does satisfy that. Okay, so that's where we're at. So what is it we do, and how do we? Yeah. What's the approach? What's this? What's the approach that we're going to use? And that's what I'm here to tell you about. And what we take this non-standard approach in the sense that we extend C. You know, in order to give some kind of notion of a regularity condition in a non-standard way, we extend C to a valued field containing C and use valuative conditions to get a notion of what it means to be roughly translationally invariant. Okay, and so as model theorists would recognize this, okay, with the t-adic valuation. Okay, which I write multiplicatively and looking like an absolute value. And so the model theorists would recognize this. I mean, is an algebraically closed valued field, equicharacteristic zero, with characteristic zero, zero, and residue field. So this will turn out to be important. I mean, is that this has a residue field. I mean, it, by its construction as a Hahn field, has residue field C. Okay, so note that I write this valuation multiplicatively. It doesn't cause much offense. Okay. And so, yeah, the question is, first, Imi's idea, how to formalize the notion of roughly translation invariant using a valued field in this kind of a non-standard way. And yeah, so that's how to formalize roughly translation invariant. Okay, and so the tool is, well, we don't think of about the set in C. Yeah, so the approach is consider, so this algebraic, so as this is an algebraically closed field in itself as a field, I mean, X also defines points in C, in C double brackets T with the value group Q. Okay, and I have intended and consider these points and then consider a valuative notion. So let's once and for all set big K to save me this Hahn series field over Q. Is that all right? Any questions, notation or anything? Okay, great. So, and well, so here's the first. Well, okay, so yeah, I mean, motivating this definition is the idea is if we look at a small part. Okay, so if we look at a small part of, an intersection with our variety, so we've got x here, and in looking on a ball here, so I'm drawing in two dimensions now. If this is very close, if it doesn't take much manipulation to get it into a straight line, then it should be, roughly one translatable. So that's what we're getting to. And so the question is how to formalize this. And this is to a Lupchok here, which I also write how. And so how Lupchok is written up there. He'll hopefully forgive me. So we say that a bijection. So remember now we're thinking of the set in the large valued field. So there's valuative balls. So we have, So we have valuative balls. And if we have two valuative balls, B and B prime, and that bijection between them is called a rhizometry. For all distinct x and y in the domain, which is a valuative ball. Okay, I'll give you the valuative condition. If the differences between the point is what to choose. I mean, so in a classical sense, you would in C or something, you would choose maps to be this, some kind of normalizing maps to be homeomorphisms or something else. Okay, and here we've got an isometry, we've got a metric space around from this ultrametric as a multimetric space. It turns out that isometry is not enough, as Pablo mentioned. So here is the notion, which works, is that the differences between differences. So it's like a condition on this kind of discrete form of the derivative. The valuation of the differences between points in the domain and the image is strictly smaller in evaluation than the distance between x and y. Okay. And I just recall, if you know RV, that's the saying that the RV of the differences between x and y is preserved by the map theta. Okay. And so, yeah, indeed. And this RV, if you look at this a moment, you'll see that if you have an isometry which preserves the valuation, it'll certainly be, a rhizometry is certainly evaluation, is it certainly preserves the valuation. So it preserves RV. So, rhizometries are isometries, but maybe for some examples to help get a picture of what they are, translations are rhizometries. Okay. And maybe a less trivial example, say on the ball evaluative. Okay, so that's the definition. I'll swap it up in a moment. Okay, so on this, the valuation real size ball, we've got a rhizometry defined. I mean, this defines a rhizometry. If you send x to x plus t of x, where t is this, I mean, where t is the t from the t-adic expansion, which we consider as an infinitesimal, plus b, okay, for any b in k. So this is a bit more interesting than a translation. That's also a rhizometry too. If you want something to an exercise, you can check that. But I mean, the point is that, I mean, in a way, these rhizometries are approximating derivatives in some kind of discrete sense, right? I mean, if you think of the derivative of this, it's very close to being one because t is an infinitesimal. I mean, and that's how it works. Okay, so the formalism will turns out to work. Okay, and so something I want to write.
Yeah.
Oh, thanks. Yes. Okay. You're doing the exercise. Thanks a lot. Yeah. In this ball. Okay. Because of the ultrametric, we can take any b in the ball, and it sends the ball to the ball. So that's a rhizometry. So is a rhizometry from b. To b. Good. Yeah. And why do we? And so how do we? So how do we get to this notion of the trans? I mean, how do we get to what does it mean to be translatable? That's what we are. So the definition there is I'm just writing out what it would be to be like actually translation invariant. Yeah. So if you have a vector subspace. So a K vector space and B ball. Is translation invariant. So is if you say is a well yeah is V well yeah translation invariant, yeah, just means on B, just means that, yeah, okay, means for all V in the vector space, which is small enough, so smaller than the radius of B, X lies in the set X if and only if X plus V also lies in the set X. Okay, I mean that's just if V is this vector space here. Yeah, I mean this line here is translation invariant on the ball here. Yeah, and again, the ultrametric equality allows you to just add small enough elements to this vector. So, yeah, I mean, x is here, x plus v is here, whereas y is not in the set, and neither is y plus v. Okay, and a set that is not translation invariant, not translation invariant for v, as well as something that's not completely flat in the v direction, right? I mean, that's clearly not translation invariant. So what's it? So the notion of almost translation invariant is that if there is a rhizometry that sends the set X to a nice translation invariant in direction V, yes, and then I mean then X would be then the almost translation, so translatable. I mean, okay, one uses the word translatable. And so to what are these rhizotrees? So to get to the point of the rhizotrees, that's a lot of definitions to build up. So the important thing, what is it about X on this ball, which is the kind of the invariant which is captured by this rhizometry, the existence of this rhizometry to this V, is the dimension the dimension of the maximal vector, maximal dimension vector space V over K, for which X is V, up to rhizometry V translated invariant. So some subset is D rhizo trivial. Again, on with respect to the ball B, if there's a D dimensional K vector space V such that X is V translation invariant, D dimensional, that's the important thing, on B, okay? That's exactly what I've just written. Such that, and most importantly, some rhizometry from the ball to the ball, such that the modified X is V translation invariant. Okay. The way it's defined, actually, it's also X, so it's on B. On B, thanks a lot, yeah. Exactly, and this modification is only up to a small thing. Okay, something that's not a rhizometry. A rotation by an angle that's not infinitesimal, for example, is not a rhizometry, because this would drag points too far away. Okay, good. Then for precision, one writes, I'll write equal to D rhizo trivial. Yeah, is then precise, right? Is precise in the natural way. So if X is D rhizo trivial on B, but not D plus one rhizo trivial on B, then it's equal to D rhizo trivial. Okay. And I won't get so the starting point that I don't get to say much about today is it's a, I mean, it means notion of a T stratification is precise, is, yeah. I mean, is using this this notion of the trivialities of the triviality space, and this is okay. This is one situation where the T stratification as he called it would coincide. I mean, well, looks also like this. In fact, that's where the intuition comes from. But as I mentioned, I don't have time to write it all out, but so this notion of T stratification, I'd say, I mean, so just to say, to say roughly, so the notion of T stratification is some of these things. Instead of smooth, we're working in definable sets in a valued field. So these should be definable. These are definable manifolds. They're closed, and X is union of connected components of the SI. And then the regularity conditions is precisely that. That on balls which do not meet lower strata, you're detrivial if you're on any ball which does not meet a lower strata. And then this stratification, as this notion of it can be called T stratification. So okay, this is maybe. One point that one thing, so while they do nice things, and as Pablo said, they, in a way, if you work with them, you can induce Whitney stratifications on definable Whitney stratifications on the rational points and the C points of the varieties. One thing that they lack, in the big field situation, is a kind of uniqueness, a canonicity. So if we just take, so, and here's an example to show. So this hyperbola has the issue. On balls, or localized around the two branches here, we're one riso trivial. And yeah, but then the problem comes, on balls localized around the origin, you seem to be too riso-trivial. There's nothing stopping you being too riso-trivial there. And then a problem comes, however. So at first sight, you might try and just put this and this branch into S1, but then there's a problem comes. When you have a ball which contains both branches here, this is zero riso-trivial. We're right zero riso-trivial. Okay, you clearly can't have any translatability here, not even in this direction, because, well, it turns out you can do the calculations. Things are going, you would have to bring, there's no isometry from this to a kind of a flattened version, because this hyperbola is just too gone. So we're zero isotrivial on this ball. However, this ball doesn't meet any point of S0 in this first attempt. So in order to obtain a T stratification here, we have to have some point somewhere local to the zero point. Now, I've drawn it many times because this is where it's where there's a lack of canonicity here. It could be, you could put any point here. You can literally put one point, or you could put many points, or it could be any of these points in the infinitesimal square. So in the maximum ideal all squared, you can put any of these points. And so, yeah, well, even for the same x. So unfortunately, T strats. So I promise you, this would be a T stratification with this these added points here, and then S1s. I mean, the balls are, I mean, S1 here, and you know, the rest in S2. But then this, yeah, are not uniquely determined. Okay, of X are not determined by X, by the definable set X. So, well, okay, that's a bit of a shame. Okay, you've loaded your fantastic things. So, but anyway, this is an aspect that, that I've taken up with IMI to, see how we can, construct something, some invariant that's actually uniquely determined by X, but related to all of this. Okay, and that's where we get to the RISO trees. I mean, so in a way, in place of the T stratifications, we use the RISO tree to encode this RISO triviality. Okay, and we define that. Okay, it's a tree, by the way, because the set of closed balls in the valued field is a tree. Because it's an orthometric space. So we define it on the set of closed balls. Of k to the n. X. In k to the n. Okay, so then L valued field definable. It's a notion for the valued field, and so something we have to add in order to gain canonicity and definability of our RISO trees. We need to add the condition that K is spherically complete. Okay, as a reminder, spherically complete, that means the intersection of any nest of balls is non-empty. Okay, and it turns out this is an important point because spherical completeness allows for a kind of rigidity. I mean, it turns out that just a lemma that turns out to be at the core of it all is that any rhizometry from a ball into the ball in a spherically complete field is actually surjective. So this induces a kind of rigidity of partitions into balls. And that's exactly what we make advantage of. Okay. So any questions? Okay. Yeah, good. Okay, so the definition that we've settled on, including the name, is that the RISO tree of X and K in the setting above of X is the partition of all that tree of closed balls into parts which are subtrees, TRD, okay, where what's the D mean here? I mean, there's no notion of dimension that, well, there's no mention of dimension here, but so this is in a way, I mean, okay, it's not, by the way, this is not a stratification. This is a Rasso tree, yeah, but it's a partition of the closed balls, okay? And so here the D has a meaning. What's its meaning is that a closed ball is in the part TR, the TRD, if and only if X is D Rasso trivial on B. Okay. So in a way, okay, so to go to this picture, the way this is solving it is giving up on the idea of actually having something which is a stratification directly. What we do is what we're doing is we're putting, to get something canonical, we're putting all of these points into TR zero. Okay, so at the cost of losing kind of stratifying the value field space, we're getting something that is canonical. Which, okay, maybe at first sight seems, yeah, well, just a bit of a sleight of hand, but it turns out to be useful in that we can, in a different way, work to induce a stratification on the residue field, so on the original C. Yeah. Please.
When you have those points, you have them to B.
No, we don't add them to X. We add them to this set TR zero. Well, what we do is we add every ball which contains any of, I mean, okay, so let's get the picture. Any ball. Which contains a maximal ideal, we put into TR0. TR0 and any ball which does not meet any of these red points in the middle, but only meets this or this. So we put all of these balls, we put into TR1. Because our set X is one translatable on them. And then any balls which are lucky enough not to mean X in this example would be in TR2.
So you're not putting the balls which intersect both components,
right? This is also in TR0 because it contains.
So you mean the one which intersects both of them?
Yeah, I mean, all the ones that intersect both of them. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. So yeah, exactly. I mean, at first, but okay. So we just encode all that information into this thing. But the in this above setting is that x and k as above. So x definable. So well, L value field definable. And K, well, it's very complete because it's well. In this case, I mean, in the way case I'm presenting, because it's this field that I said it was, TR, this partition is is definable. Of C balls n. Yeah? Yes, yeah. Thank you. Yes, thank you. Okay, very observant, yeah. So each closed ball on X, I mean, if you consider X on every closed ball has precisely one dimension, I mean, you know, one Rasso triviality. status. So, you know, X is either, you know, from one up to n trivial, and on that ball, you put it into TRD if and only if X is equal to D, right, so trivial on B. Okay. So, the main point of this, okay, putting it all together in a tree was maybe it's not the idea. The point is actually because of the spherical completeness of K, it turns out that this notion, this being D right so trivial turns out to be a definable condition. Okay, and so I've stated it in a way that this is a definable partition of C balls. Yeah? This is a good thing, because it turns out this doesn't happen. I mean, in the original T stratifications, it's not entirely, you had to stratify before you get the balls, before you get this definability.
Sorry.
Yeah. I'm presenting it in this case. And if you want to know, I mean, the condition really is it's a very complete model of an extra characteristic zero tensor minimal expansion of a valued field. But I'm not going to manage to go into that. But yeah, in this case, so for the case I'm presenting, it, because of the spherical completeness, which is an important thing, it's in a particular case. Okay. How much time do I have left?
5-10 minutes. It's
time. Okay, thanks a lot. Okay, great. My watch is a bit confusing. Okay. Good, okay, and so, well, what do we do with this? Which is maybe the point of defining it. So previously with the, yeah. T stratification, so I mean, one can try and induce a stratification on the rational points, but then one has to work to get a stratification. And it turns out, due to this non-canonicity, that would also be non-canonical. We found another way of using this to induce a stratification in a somewhat different way, also with a bit of work. I mean, with also some work. Okay. So what we get is, we use the shadow of the riser tree to induce a stratification. And so what do? We're trying to get something which is a partition of the, you know, of C to the N, yeah, which is the residue field to the N, remember. And we put this won't turn out to be a stratification, but at least we're partitioning C to the N into pieces. We put X in the Rth shadow of the definable set X. So this is if and only if, when we consider the valued field points of X, that is precisely equal to R. That's R riso trivial on the maximal ideal size ball when considered in K. Okay. So we're giving a condition of, so this is a subset of C to the N, but we use Now we go, we kind of blow up and go into the non-center, the valued field, and then we consider this condition to decide whether or not we put this rational point in this R place. And the whole point of the whole point of this here is it turns out that this is a definable condition. So yeah. So the pro here, good. Okay, so here what have we got? We've got something that a good thing is the right hand side is definable by the Riso tree theorem. Riso tree definability. Okay. This exact well, the thing is, well, x, okay. X is a well, it's the I mean it's a it's an L ring definable set. So we can consider points of it over C, but we can also consider points of it over K. So yeah. And it's defined over C, yeah. Yeah, defined over C. That's a good point. Yeah, and to talk through this. Well, I mean, so this is, and the point is, what we really want, of course, if we're stratifying an L ring definable subset of C, we really want the partition that we end up with. Well, then, and the stratification we end up with to be L ring definable. And this is where we use model theory of ACVF. So, I mean, our work here, I mean, this theorem gives that this is LVF definable, but because in ACVF, the residue field, the structure induced on the residue field is a pure field, it's a pure L ring, yeah? So okay, by the model theory of ACVF. So this is where I think this is where there's an application of model theory of valued fields. So this is the point to put it. The model theory of ACVF, we get this really. These subsets are actually L ring definable. Okay. Now, okay. The sad point is, it turns out that these on their own. So this also provides this also is a partition of the. So it's a definable partition of C to the N. Just it turns out that the union of strata is not closed. It's a counterexample. But there's a way to fix this. And so we define, con is that less than R of X may not be closed. So we fix it by iterating. So iterate to get this. So the final point is the final definition is a Riso stratification this induced stratification of X is. So now it's really something which is a stratification of C to the N, yeah, where we use the shadows iterated, at most n times. So where inductively S H R S of
x is equal to the shadow of the kind of the composite SH L R of x for the L less than s. Okay.
So I could I didn't have time to go through that slowly, but effectively if you iterate the shadow taking process at most n times, you do get closed subsets, and in fact you get something that is somewhat nice. What we get is that so X L the ring definable. We have for each R less than equal to N, this induced Riesz stratification, and you look at the complex points, is L ring definable. The dimensions in the notion of dimension for C is R for each, is the most R for each SRC, and the unions are closed, and moreover, for the appropriate notion of, Whitney stratification, so I'm putting a caveat here, L ring Whitney stratification. Of X. And So L Whitney, L ring, maybe I should write C1. It's not, many people mean it's completely smooth, but okay. So maybe it's a kind of, but it satisfies the Whitney conditions. The Whitney regularity conditions, and it's some it's a notion of thing. And okay, and the point is, is that by construction, monocle. Okay, that's where I stop.
Thank you very much. Are there any questions? Online, maybe. So thank you again. Sorry, I didn't.
Can you explain a bit more the role of the spherical completeness on this theorem, please?
Well, I would say, it's the role of the spherical completeness turns out the key property. Is this point that if you have a rhizometry, rhizometry from a ball into itself, if your field is not spherically complete, you can get the descending chains. You don't have a good rigidity, but is automatically a surjective, provided K is very complete. And otherwise not. So it turns out that is maybe the core point. But it turns out this is okay. Okay, it turns out this is not a restriction because we, I mean, we had to then work, but we proved that in fact in the settings, also in the level of generality we're working, actually spherically complete models exist. And so this was some, yeah, although that didn't turn out, I mean, turn out need proving, but yeah.
Any other questions? Oh, thank you very much for the talk.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. My apologies, I think there was some minutes. Oh, okay. Maybe not. Just one.